Molly， 那我们也非常高兴今天晚上能够再一次邀请到我们的理智人大师 Jeannie。Jeannie 今天晚上将会带我们一起来了解与法国比肩的另外一个葡萄酒大国意大利。而在意大利呢，它有两个产区特别的为人瞩目，这两个产区就是托斯卡纳跟皮埃蒙特。那么我们现在就赶紧开始吧，把时间交给我们的 Jeannie。
Thank you, Molly. I'm delighted to be talking about Italy. I think it's one of the most exciting countries because it's important in terms of how much it produces. It's usually number one or two, depending on the year, with France in terms of how much volume it produces and the exports. So it's an extremely important country, both in terms of production and as one of the top five consumers of wine as well.
Jeannie 呢，非常高兴今天能够跟大家一起来分享和了解意大利这个国家。这个国家呢是世界上最令人兴奋的葡萄酒产国之一，因为它不管是从产量还是从出口量方面来说呢，都是一个非常重要的国家。它的出口量呢，在世界上排名第一位。
But I think there are a lot of people who might be a little bit confused, with all the different Italian wines. Well.To go back to history a little bit, we know that it's the Roman Empire that spread vines and grape growing all over Europe. And 2,000 years ago, the Romans were the most important civilization with about 20% of the world's population under its kingdom. So this spreading of wine culture was very much part and parcel of what Italy is all about. It's this part of its identity.
我们都知道呢，历史上呢，意大利是罗马帝国的一部分。罗马帝国是历史上最为强大的帝国，可以说是最大、最强大的帝国。它的人口呢，占到了全世界人口的20%。可以说，罗马帝国的扩张呢，是意大利历史中不可或缺的一部分。
But even though Italy was such an important and ancient civilization.It didn't really become a country, a nation state until the 1860s. And what that meant was that it's only about 150 years old. And there's so much fragmentation, so much strong identity within each region that even if you go from Piedmont and very, very close, Tuscany is just southeast of Piedmont, you find almost a totally different culture, both in terms of wine,language, food, just about everything.
虽然说在历史上意大利它的古文明非常的璀璨，但是它直到1960年呢才建立起来，这个国家真正建立起来只有150年的时间。我们可以看到不同的产区呢，不同的省，他们的文化其实都是非常独特的。就比如说皮埃蒙特，从饮食啊文化上来说，都跟其他的省有着不一样，有着独特性。
So it was not until the 1960s when suddenly you had laws being created about what quality regions there were. So if you compare that with France, France had already started this in the 1930s. So 30 years later is when the entire quality.Controlled geographical designations, what the Italians call the DOC and DOCG, and later the IGT was created.
跟法国比起来呢，意大利它的等级制度就是屏幕上方大家可以看到的 DOC 和 DOCG， 以及稍晚的 IGT， 它的建立时间呢比法国要晚了30年，就是到1960年才建立起来的。
So DOC stands for Denominación de Origen Controlada. It means it controls the region of origin. And then the DOCG is a guaranteed that it's added, considered a little more prestigious because there are far few. There's only 70 somewhat DOCGs compared to DOCs, which are in the hundreds. So what that means is that when people look at a wine with DOC and DOCG,Does that necessarily mean higher quality? And I'm going to argue it's both yes and no.
好，我们可以了解到呢，其实DOCG 呢，它整个数量只有332个，比起 DOC 呢73个，其实还是多很多的。那么这两个法定的等级制度， 它们是不是就是意味着质量的保证呢？那我们今天就要来看一下。
So when you're part of the DOC-DOCG system, it means that the certain grape variety that you use, the minimum alcohol level, the, even the aging requirements is already preset. So it means that you have to abide by these regulations. And within it, you can make fantastic wines. And the regions that have DOC and DOCG usually do mean that they are more conscientious because there's a minimum quality ripeness requirement and aging requirement. But at the same time, many Italians who are very independent, they are not interested in abiding by the laws. And so we'll see when we go on to talk about Super Tuscans why there are a lot of people who decided to come out of the regulation and still become superstars.
其实呢，我们也可以说它是这个DOCG 和 DOC 这个等级制度是可以反映质量的，因为他们规定了葡萄品酿酒的葡萄品种，还有它的酒精度以及它的熟化的时间。你如果要称为 DOC 和 DOCG 酒呢，你必须要遵循这些法规，所以它其实在一定的程度上也可以反映葡萄酒的品质。但是呢，其实意大利有很多的产区他们是不遵循这个法规的。它在这里面最为突出的一个例子就是超级托斯卡纳，这个产区就没有遵守 DOC 和 DOC 的法规制度，但是后来成为了一个超级明星酒款。
So what's happened when you compare, and people who understand and appreciate French wines will see that the regulation under the Italian laws are two ways very very different. The first way is that Italian laws have an aging requirement within the DOC and DOCG, whereas French wine laws do not.
当我们对比法国和意大利的这个等级法规制度的时候呢，我们可以发现有两个最大的不同。第一个呢，就是意大利它要求了最低的熟化时间，但是法国并没有。
And the other main difference between DOC and DOCG with French regulations is that there really is no quality pyramid. So if we go to compare it to Bordeaux, for example, you have the 1855 classification, there's first growth down to fifth growth, but in the Italian system, there really is no growth or quality levels as such. There are only specified regions, and within that region, the reputation is really from the producer and the quality of wines that the region has been producing.
第二个最大的不同呢，就是意大利它的这个等级制度并没有要求和说明它的一个质量。就拿波尔多来比较吧，波尔多它有1855分级，这些可以说明葡萄酒品质的一个等级制度，但是意大利并没有，它只是规定了那个产区，而且和葡萄品种还有酒精度和陈酿时间等等，但是它并不是说明质量。
So we're left as consumers to choose with really two things going for us. First is a reputation of the region, and we know the kind of reputation that a region like Barolo or Barbaresco must have. And because the wines are often named by the regions, this gives a very clear indication. That's one way. And the second way is really the reputation of the winemaker and producer.
那我们在选购葡萄酒的时候该怎么办呢？因为它又没有一个特别明确的等级制度告诉我们它质量如何。那 Jeannie 呢就告诉我们有两个方法。第一个方法就是我们从它的产区去选择产区的声誉，比如说巴罗洛和巴巴莱斯科。当我们看到这两个酒款，就两个 DOCG 产区的时候，我们就知道这两个产区是两个不错的产区，那么它出产的葡萄酒是相当不错的。还有第二个就是根据出产商，比如说酒庄他们的声誉，如果是一个好的酒庄呢，那他们出产的葡萄酒也会比较的优质。
So it's important to know some of the terms on the Italian wine label. So you'll be seeing DOC, DOCG as indicators of a specific region abiding by their rules. And then you'll see another category called the IGT. And this is a specific geographical zone that indicates that it hasn't quite reached the requirements of DOC and DOCG, which are much stricter. So the IGTs that really came into play in the 1990s was because of the Super Tuscans, the renegades who actually didn't want to follow the rules, decided that they don't just want to plant Sangiovese. Why not Cabernet? Why not Merlot? Why not Cabernet Franc? And it was these Super Tuscans that then enabled the IGT to come into fruition and to give another category, which also indicates quality.
那我们现在就来了解一下比较重要的一些酒标术语。我们可以看到，在大屏幕上可以看到，DOC 和 DOCG 这两个术语在之前我们也提过了。那现在呢，就你重点在讲这个 IGT 这个地区餐酒这个术语。IGT 呢，它的这个酒标术语呢，跟 DOCG 还有 DOC 不同，它没有那么严，它并没有这个被划为这个等级的葡萄酒呢，并没有遵循那么像 DOC 和 DOCG 那么严格的标准，而这个酒标术语呢，是因为超级托斯卡纳才被引入的。那个时候呢，酿酒酒庄和生产商他们并不想使用100%的香蕉维塞进行酿酒，他们想要试一下国际品种。我们为什么不试一下国际品种呢？像是赤霞珠、梅洛等等。所以呢，就因为这样 IGT 这个酒标术语呢应运而生。
So the other terms on the wine label that you might come across very often is Classico. And Classico basically means it's the oldest and most historic part of that region. So when you see Chianti and you see Chianti Classico, so Classico means that this is the original, historical, oldest part and usually a smaller region, indicating a higher quality place.
那接下来我们来看一下其他的一些酒标术语。其他一些酒标术语呢，包括经典，就是第一个刚才经理说到的这个酒标术语，其实说的是它意指这款酒来自更好的更古老的历史上最原始的那个产区。比如说我们拿基安蒂来做一个例子，基安蒂和经典基安蒂呢，经典基安蒂就意味着是最古老最原始的那一块基安蒂产区。
So you'll also see Reserva on the label. And Reserva simply means that it had a longer aging period. Is longer aging for wine usually good? It means that it could be good. Usually producers save the very best quality wines that can be aged longer in their Reserva. But it's also a term that could be abused by producers because they feel that aging it for a year longer will enable them to put it at a higher price.
另外一个酒标术语呢是珍藏。这个酒标术语一般代表着更长的熟化时间，通常呢是一年。其实很多时候这个术语可能意味对很多人来说意味着更好的质量，因为它经过了更长的熟化时间，但是一些生产者并不这么认为，而且他们觉得呢，现在可以缩短一些熟化时间，让酒款更早的上市。
So you can see how important for Italians the aging is. It means that the longer you age it, traditionally it meant that it was higher quality. And so you see that in almost every regulation within Italy. You'll also see another term called superiore. And superiore means that it had a little bit more alcohol. So the minimum alcohol level is around 0.5 degrees higher than one without such a term. And again, this can be a term that can be abused because not just because it has a little bit more alcohol doesn't always mean that it's a better quality. But generally speaking, when the harvest is good and when the wine is made with a little bit more sugar and sweetness, it is a better quality wine.
再来就是超级这个酒标术语。这个酒标术语意味着比法这款酒呢，具有比法规要求的更高的酒精度，一般是0.5%。这个酒标术语其实也有一点被过度的使用，因为 这个酒标术语其实并不代表说更高的酒精度它的那个质量就会更好，其实很多时候呢是根据当年那个葡萄采摘葡萄的原料，它的那个含糖量如果是更高的话，其实往往意味着这款酒可能是更好的质量。
Great. Now I think we should really go into a specific region because Italy is such a big country. It's really hard to cover everything. But Tuscany is the region that I feel is probably the most familiar with a lot of Asian people. You've heard Chianti. It is from Italy, the most widely exported wine, and it's in every Italian restaurant and shop. And I think Chianti stands at the core of what Tuscany is all about.
因为意大利它这个国家非常大，那我们现在呢就专注于两个产区。刚刚在开头也提到了，现在呢我们就进入第一个产区托斯卡纳。提到托斯卡纳，不得不提的就是基安蒂这个产区。基安蒂呢，它不仅是在国际上面最出名的一个意大利酒款，它同时还是出口量最大的一个酒款。我们可以在意大利的餐馆呢，其实。在我们国家餐馆里面，可能也能够寻找到这一个酒款。
So we can't start talking about Tuscany before we talk about the most important grape variety in the entire region, which is Sangiovese. And Sangiovese is planted throughout Italy, but it is really the king in Tuscany.
那我们现在呢，就来讲一下托斯卡纳，基安蒂和托斯卡纳最主要的一个品种，这就是。那就是就是桑娇维塞了。这个品种呢，可以说是托斯卡纳的明星品种，也是最重要的品种。
So Sangiovese has pretty good acidity. It also has pretty firm tannins, and there's a whole range of different cherry fruit that you can find in Sangiovese, from light red, bright ripe cherries to dark or even sour cherries. So you have this whole spectrum of dark cherry flavors, and at the same time, it's supported by these firm tannins. And it's a grape variety that likes oak. So, whether you use the traditional Slovenian or large oak casks, or you use the French barriques, Sangiovese marries very well and ages well in oak.
桑娇维塞这个品种呢，它具有十分好的，十分高的酸度跟单宁。它的这个品种呢，有着非常丰富的、非常浓郁的樱桃的风味。这个风味呢，可能是深色樱桃，也可能是酸樱桃。除此之外呢，它和橡木桶可以很好的结合，不管是使用大橡木桶还是法国小橡木桶，这个葡萄品种呢，都可以很完美的消化。
And the reason I say that Sangiovese is sort of the heart of Tuscany and maybe even represents Italy is because the grape variety is absolutely perfect for food. It was made with this freshness in the back of its core. It was made with fairly moderate alcohol levels, so it's not obtrusive or too big. And at the same time, it's also a very good mutation. So what that means is throughout Tuscany, you will actually see a lot of different clones of Sangiovese. We're going to try two today, and you'll see that they're very different because, like Pinot Noir, whenever it travels from one place to another, it expresses another identity.
桑娇维塞呢，可以说是意大利的代表性品种，而且它跟食物能够非常好的结合，它非常适合搭配食物来饮用。它的酒精度呢，一般只是中等酒精度，所以它不会给人一种很厚重、很宏大，就是压得人喘不过气来的那种感觉。同时呢，它的成熟度也是非常好的。我们可以看到，桑娇维塞其实有很多的不同的克隆品种，接下来呢，我们也会品尝到两个它的克隆品种所酿造的酒款，像黑皮诺一样，桑娇维塞这个品种，不管是它种在不同的地方，它就有不同的特性，可以反映不同的风土，是一个非常神奇的葡萄品种。
You'll see on the label with Chianti that there are seven different variations or names of Chianti. So just Chianti by itself, and then you'll see Chianti Classico, and we already discussed that it's the oldest, most historic place. But you also see Chianti Raffina, Chianti Colli, and many others.
江地这个产区呢，它一共有七个卫星产区，就七个子产区。我们可以看到有古典江地啊，还有比如说鲁芬纳江地，这些呢都是它的子产区。刚才还漏了一点，就是经理还说到古典江地，就像我们刚刚提到的一样，有了 classical 古典这个词呢，它意味着更小的、更原始的、更好的江地这个地块，它这个产区。
So this is where it really helps to know the region and be familiar. So for Chianti, please remember Chianti Classico as the smaller sub-region of high quality. Chianti Raffina, which is also just north of Chianti Classico, a very small region that produces really great Chiantis. They're more expensive than just a basic Chianti, but definitely worth paying a little bit more.
Jeannie 刚刚讲到呢，经典基安地这个产区呢，相比它这个产区是更小的，然后品质也是更高的一个产区。但是我们还可以看到鲁芬纳这个产区，它这个子产区同样也是很小的，它的品质呢也同样很高，可是呢它的酒款价格可能就会更高，或者是就比较昂贵一些。我们平常消费者看到的时候觉得，哇，怎么价格这么高呀？但是其实它的品质是值得它这样价格的。
One of my favorite regions in Tuscany is a region called Montalcino, and this is where they have a clone of Sangiovese. They call it Brunello di Montalcino, and it produces a very pure, very long-aged, intense, concentrated style of Sangiovese, very different from Chianti. And this is where you'll see that it is regulated by the region to be 100% Sangiovese, whereas in Chianti, you can have up to 30% other varieties blended in.
Jeannie 最爱的一个产区呢，产区之一是就是布鲁奈罗蒙塔奇诺这个产区，它的那个酒的风味非常的浓郁，非常的集中，而且它的法规规定只能使用100%的香蕉维塞进行酿造葡萄酒。它跟江地的其他葡萄酒款，江地的酒款不同，江地的经典江地酒款呢，允许有20%的其他品种加入来混酿。
So two other regions I must mention within Tuscany, which is really worth your time, is Vino Nobile di Montepulciano, and the other is Bulgari. Bulgari became a DOC because that there were so many super Tuscans and very innovative producers that started producing great wine. But Vino Nobile di Montepulciano, like Brunello di Montalcino, is 100% Sangiovese, has its own very unique style, even though it's very close to Chianti. So the regions and the differences, if you ever have a chance to compare, especially from the same vintage, is really worth discovering how different and how varied Sangiovese can be.
那还有另外一个Jeannie 也非常想要提，觉得非常值得一提的那个产区是高贵蒙特布查诺产区。这个产区呢同样也是使用100%香蕉维塞来酿酒的。它跟江地呢虽然地理位置上比较接近，但是其实他们的酒款风格是非常的不同的。那我们现在就来尝一尝这款酒吧。
So I think it's time to taste a little bit of Tuscan wine. So the first one that I have is Podere Brizio, Brunello di Montalcino. As I told you, one of my favorite regions, I love the purity of having 100% Sangiovese in the wine. I also appreciate that this is a 10-year-old wine from a very good vintage, 2007.
现在呢，我们就来品鉴第一款酒。第一款酒呢是来自布里奇奥酒庄的布鲁奈罗葡萄酒，这款葡萄酒呢它非常的纯净，到目前为止已经有10年的陈酿时间了，是在2007年推出的。
So this is a certified organic vineyard established in 1996, so a fairly young producer.And you can see that there has been some modern techniques used because the fruit is bright. Normally, I expect Brunello di Montalcino to have structure, and this one does. But after 10 years of age, it has just started to open up, and show its earthy, savory spices, these roasted herbs, roasted Italian herbs, and a kind of earthiness with really dark cherry fruit.
这款酒呢，它是来自于一个取得了有机认证的一个酒庄。它在酿酒的过程当中呢，使用了很多的现代的酿酒技术，是一个比较现代化风格的酒商，的酒庄。这款酒呢，在我们品尝，在经历品尝的时候呢，有非常丰富的泥土和香料的香味，还有非常浓郁的深色樱桃的风味。
So this is when Great Brunello comes into play.At around 10 years of age, when it starts to change from its young, more fruit and primary flavor driven to more evolved notes. And this is at the stage now just starting to open. And you can see that with the kind of modern, and I call it modern because they're using French oak, but it's not small barriques, it's large 3,600 liter big casks of French oak that they aged for 3.5 years. And of course, for it to be Brunello, the winery has to keep it in their cellar for 5 years before it can be sold in the market.
这款酒它现在的状态呢，就是正好刚刚才在刚刚打开它风味的一个状态，因为一般布鲁奈罗的酒呢，它需要10年的时间陈酿，然后它的风味会在这10年时间内慢慢的发展，然后发展出更多的更富裕的风味。这款酒呢，就是它的风味在刚刚打开的阶段当中。为什么刚才经理说这款酒是比较现代的一个风格呢？就是因为酒庄在酿酒的过程当中使用到了法国桶。他说的那个法国橡木桶不是那种法国小橡木桶，而是370升的那种大的橡木桶。而他在这个橡木桶当中陈酿了3.5年的时间。布鲁奈罗蒙塔奇诺呢，其实在上市之前是需要经过5年的陈酿时间的。
So now we have something very, very different, and I wanted to make sure that we covered Super Tuscans properly, because when that term came into play, it was not really a term that I think that the producers themselves really said, oh, we want to be a Super Tuscan. It was coined by a lot of writers and journalists, and what it meant is that although they fell out of this DOC, DOCG appellation, controlled region, they still were producing fantastic wines without the regulation. And in fact, they were super because they were charging super duper prices and the market still bought them. They thought the quality was that high that it didn't need that kind of regulation to get very high prices and also very high points and scores from critics.
他在品酒品鉴下一款酒之前，他是想说一下超级托斯卡纳这个酒款，它是属于 IGT 地区餐酒的。这个等级的酒呢，它最初是由于酿酒师们他们想跳脱出 DOC 跟 DOCG 这个等级制度的局限性，因为他们想要酿造使用非本地品种来酿造更加高品质的葡萄酒款。葡萄酒，他们在这个超级托斯卡纳在刚刚上市的时候呢，价格就已经非常高了。但是因为他们的质量也非常的好，所以呢，人们愿意花高价去买这样一款酒。除此之外呢，很多的酒评家也给这款酒给超级托斯卡纳打到了非常高的分数。
So this wine is a 2012 Lucere Nuove del Ornellaia. And I think everyone knows Ornellaia very well. It's one of the original Super Tuscans, established in 1981, a great reputation winery that's collected by all the Italian and fine wine collectors around the world. So this is Ornellaia's little brother. And I say little only because the prices are low, but the quality is incredibly high. A great value red that's really made with majority Merlot.
现在 Jeannie 品鉴的呢是我们本次直播的第二款酒，这款酒是来自奥纳亚酒庄的勒塞瑞红葡萄酒。这个酒庄呢，相信一提到大家都是。可能很多人都是知道的，因为奥纳亚这个酒庄实在是太有名了。它是建立于1981年。那我们经理现在品鉴的这一款酒呢， 它虽然不是这个酒庄的正牌酒，但是它的品质也非常非常的出色，可以说是正牌酒的小兄弟。
This is not a typical Merlot, however. This is from Bulgari, and that means that rather than just having big, soft, plummy fruit, you've got a backbone of very firm acidity and very firm tannins. It's full-bodied, it's generous, it's lush, it has cocoa notes, hint of chocolate, and also dark blackberry fruit. It's very young, drinking beautifully now, but a wine that will really age for definitely at least 10 years.
这款酒呢是来自于宝格丽这个产区的，现在经历品尝的时候就可以感觉到非常坚实的单宁跟酸度，同时呢还可以品尝到像可可啊巧克力之类的风味，还有非常浓郁的黑莓风味。虽然这款酒现在还非常的年轻，但是它饮用起来已经是给人非常愉悦的感觉，这款酒至少还可以再陈年十年的时间。
And part of what makes this super Tuscan is because you're not using Sangiovese. It's 52% Merlot, and the rest is Cabernet Sauvignon, Cabernet Franc, Petit Verdot, and also French oak barrels are used, about 25% new. So it does taste like an international, style that really you would think it could be from anywhere, but because of the structure and its style and its the way it expresses itself, it is definitely an Italian Bordeaux blend.
这款酒它的特别之处就是它不使用香蕉维塞，而是使用国际葡萄品种，最主要的品种是梅洛。除此之外呢，还使用了赤霞珠啊，还有品丽珠这些国际葡萄品种。它在酿造的过程中呢，使用了法国橡木桶，其中有25%是新橡木桶。这款酒我们在品尝的时候就可以发现它的风格非常的国际化，可以说是一款非常典型的、具有代表性的波尔多混酿风格的一个意大利酒款。
So Molly, should we take a few questions from the audience since this is live?
Yeah. Okay. 那我们现在呢就来挑选一些热心观众发来的问题。我们现在就进入问答环节。我现在呢就从手机上面来挑选一些观众的问题，邀请经理来为我们解答。
So please send questions if you have any.
We'll be looking at them.
Okay.
Maybe this one. It is said that why.
Why don't you?
Okay.
Mm-hmm.这个问题呢是说，近几年呢，据说巴罗洛和巴巴莱斯科地区的酿酒商在尝试现代风格的葡萄酒。那么，请问大师呢，这种现代化的风格有什么特别的地方吗？
It is said that winemakers in Barolo and Barbaresco tried to make wine of modern style in recent years. Can you talk about? Is there any speciality of modern style?
Well, the modern style really started as an innovative way of approaching wine, influenced by quite a lot from Bordeaux. And this began in the 80s. So when you look at how wines have changed, and it's still a debate that's ongoing in a lot of regions, including Tuscany and Piedmont, about all these modern techniques and modern styles. And I'll describe them in a minute.
Okay. 这个现代风格可以说是从波尔多掀起的一个风格的风潮，它是在80年代兴起的，但现在呢还在发展当中。比如像托斯卡纳呀、皮埃蒙特这些产区都有受到这个风潮的影响。然后经理接下来会更加详细的再说一下。
So first, when you look at the vineyard, you know that for a more modern style producer, they look for more ripeness. They are harvesting as late as possible so that they can have a great color, deep intensity, and lots of ripe flavors. That's the first step.
第一点，它的特别之处的第一点呢，就是在葡萄园内呢，酿酒者会尽量延长他们收获的时间，使葡萄呢更加的成熟。这样呢，葡萄可以达到一个比较深色的状态，而且它的风味也更加的浓郁，更加的集中。
So when the grapes are brought into the winery, the other thing that happens is that there's a lot of sorting and very careful selection using modern techniques, sorting tables, optical, machines that can sort ripe and unripe berries. And so with these ripe berries, there is a shorter maceration because back in the old days, Italians loved to keep the skin and the seeds and all the tannins in the skin and the core of the grapes together with the juice for a long time, making it a very tannic, tough style when it was young. But the modern style prefers not to do that, to have shorter, more fruit, flavor-focused expression of the wine.
第二点呢，就是在酿酒厂里面的酿酒厂呢，现在已经引用了非常多现代的技术来挑选这个葡萄。他们会在现代的那些分拣台上面来挑选葡萄，可以挑选出成熟的和不成熟的，来去掉那些不成熟的葡萄。并且呢，他们还会进行更短时间的一个浸皮，因为在过去呢，在意大利酿酒师们常常会将葡萄汁跟他们的皮啊梗啊一起浸渍，然后浸渍非常长的一段时间，这样呢就会造成那个葡萄酒呢单宁非常的多，喝起来会很炸口。那现在呢酒庄就会比较倾向于使用更短的浸皮的时间，这样呢葡萄酒也会更加的易饮一些。
So once the wine is pressed off its skins and seeds are all removed and you have the juice, then what the modern producers like to do is put it in smaller oak barrels, but for a shorter period of time. So they don't want the long maceration in a large oak barrel. They want it to be very precise, very short, to preserve the flavors that they had found in the ripe grapes. And so the wines, it's not that the wines are released earlier. They may age it in a bottle, keep it in their cellar for a few years. But it's that the flavors that are in the modern styles are more fruit-driven, they're more about ripeness and more precise flavors, whereas the traditional styles are more earthy, more savory, more evolved. And no, it's a difference. It's not that one is better than the other. They're very two different styles, both with producers that are making excellent wines of that style.
除了那个缩短浸皮时间以外呢，就是酿酒师呢还会使用小的橡木桶去进行陈酿，并且呢缩短那个葡萄酒的陈酿时间，去保留那个葡萄品种当中的品种风味，他们很精细的那些风味，但是并不是说他们就不经过陈年了，他们依旧会经过陈年，只不过是呢，陈酿的时间会使那个果味更加多的保留下来，那些精细的果味能够保留下来。在过去传统的风格可能是更多的泥土风味，但是并不是说传统风味可能传统的风格它就比现代的风格要略逊，只不过是酿酒师他比较趋向于使用哪一种风格，并没有说哪一个比较好。
So let's take one small question. I know this was a long one, but maybe we can choose one more question and then we go on to Piedmont.
Okay, and this one?
How to pair Barolo with food? Okay.
这个问题是问巴罗洛适合搭配什么样的食物呢？
SoBarolo is 100% Nebbiolo. That's one of the specific things about Piedmont region, that there's a lot of single varieties that are focused and pure in its expression. And Barolo is a classic, very tannic style. But again, it depends on the age of the Barolo. If you're having a young Barolo, I would say that you definitely need some red meats,some barbecue, some stew, braised foods. It can be anything from lamb to beef to mutton. Any of the, you know, heavy, big, meaty flavors work really well with Barolo, young Barolo.
我们知道那个巴罗洛是使用100%的内比奥罗来酿造的，它这个葡萄，这个酒款呢，其实风味是非常的纯净的，它也非常的经典。更多的时候是展现一种很成熟的风味，那这个时候呢搭配一些烤啊红烧啊之类的肉类的，比如说像牛肉这样的菜肴会更加的合适。 特别是跟那些重口味的肉类菜肴会更加的搭。
But I think Barolo doesn't always have to be that strong and intense, because when it's about 20, 30 years old and you have some wonderful Barolos from the 80s that are drinking beautifully now, like the 82 or 85, then for sure you can use some white meats or poultry, such as roast goose, roast duck, even some of the seafood dishes that have full flavor, and meats that are lighter, any kind of chicken dish also can work very well with Barolo. So it really depends on the age of the wine.
如果是比较年轻的，这个搭配其实我们可以从那个酒款陈酿的时间来选择。如果是一款比较年轻的酒款，其实我们还是可以搭配一些口味比较轻的肉类的菜肴，比如说鹅啊、鸡肉啊，我们都可以进行搭配。
So let's go into Piedmont now. It's a region that is specifically close to my heart because I've been there numerous times, actually more often than to Tuscany. And it's not because of the wine only that attracts me to Piedmont, but also its food. If you've ever had white truffles from Alba, I think you know that you've tasted a little piece of heaven.
现在呢，我们就开始进入下一个产区皮埃蒙特。这个产区除了它的葡萄酒以外呢，还有一个非常吸引 Jeannie 的地方，就是它的美食。
I love the scenery of Piedmont, and even though Tuscany as well has the beautiful rolling hills and the villas and the villages on top of mountains, Piedmont has a bit more of a rugged, harder feel, only because the mountains are bigger and taller. Piedmont as a region is surrounded by the Alps mountains, and that borders France on its east and, the west of Piedmont, and on its east-northwest border, you have Switzerland, the Swiss Alps. So you have these huge mountains surrounding this region and giving it this sort of a majestic atmosphere. And Piedmont as a region means the foot of the mountains.
皮埃蒙特这个产区呢，它的名字的字面意思就是山脚下。刚才君你谈到呢，这个产区虽然说托斯卡纳这个刚刚提到的那个产区，它的风景也十分的优美，但是皮埃蒙特的产区呢更为吸引君你，因为这个地方的山很多也很高。它是建立在阿尔卑斯的山路地带的，它南接法国，北接瑞士，就是一个大山包围的趋势，所以它的风景十分的独特。
I also enjoy it that Piedmont has grape varieties that are not blended. Very often throughout Tuscany, you find Sangiovese blended with other regions. Of course, there are exceptions like Brunello di Montalcino, but through and large, traditionally, Sangiovese has been blended 20-30% with other varieties. And in Piedmont, that has never been the case. So you have straight Nebbiolo, straight Barbera, straight Dolcetto, and Moscato for its whites, or Cortese.
跟托斯卡纳这个产区比起来呢，皮埃蒙特这个产区在葡萄品种上会更加的单一。像之前我们提到的托斯卡纳这个产区呢，它会使用其他的葡萄品种跟香蕉维塞进行混酿，可是在皮埃蒙特呢，我们只能找到单一的葡萄品种的酒款，比如说是单一的内比奥罗、单一的巴贝达、单一的多姿桃，就没有说是有混酿品种混酿的葡萄酒款的。
So in Piedmont, it's just as important to know the actual grapes themselves. So let's start with the king of grapes in Piedmont, which is Nebbiolo. So it's 100% Barolo. It's made up of 100%. Barbaresco. So Nebbiolo is where you find the most expensive, the most age-worthy wines. This is a thin-skinned grape, very difficult and particular to grow. Very high acid, very high tannins, but little color, like Pinot Noir, and a wonderful perfume that ranges from earth to truffles, to florals, to violets and roses. And it has this real combination of intensity, strength, and as well as delicacy.
现在我们就来谈一下皮埃蒙特这个产区最为重要的一个葡萄品种，那就是内比奥罗。它可以说是皮埃蒙特这个产区的葡萄品种之王。这个葡萄品种呢，它非常的难养，因为它的产量很低，是一个比较金贵的葡萄品种。可是呢，它有非常浓郁的风味，而且它的陈年潜力呢非常的好。像皮埃蒙特一样，这个葡萄品种它的颜色非常的浅淡，可是呢，它的单宁跟酸度都很高，而且除了这些特征之外呢，它的风味呢也是十分的浓郁，比如说有花香啊，包括紫罗兰的香味，那对，就是这些。
So the other grape variety from Piedmont that I'm a huge fan of is Barbera. And when I'm in a restaurant, this is the variety that I normally choose. Most of the Barolos and Barbarescos are a little bit too young, and I know they're going to be tannic and hard, but Barberas, because they're high in acid, so it means it's refreshing. It's also dark fruit driven, and the tannins are relatively light to medium, which means it's soft and approachable even if it's young. So it's a great food wine, and because of the acidity, it goes with everything from seafood dishes all the way to salads and antipasti and meats and just about anything. So it's a perfect food wine that is a go-to, very well priced.
还有一个葡萄品种 Jeannie 也非常的喜欢，这个葡萄品种就是巴贝拉。这个葡萄品种呢，是它会在餐厅里面选择的一个最常选择的一个葡萄品种。这个葡萄品种呢，它非常的新鲜，而且会带有深色水果的风味。和内比奥罗不同，这个葡萄品种它的单宁含量比较低，所以呢，它在年轻的时候就已经非常的适应，并且它和食物搭配呢，它和食物非常的合拍。不管是海鲜还是肉类食品，或者是说像意大利面啊，任何的食物都可以搭配，并且它的价格呢也是非常的亲民的。
So now we go to two other grape varieties that are not as well known but still incredibly popular, especially in Italy, the Dolcetto grape. This is very affordable, easygoing, everyday type of red. And the reason I prefer the Barbera is because Dolcetto tends to be higher in tannins. So it's very good when you're having meat-based dishes, but for more all-around, Barbera as a grape variety is more flexible. But Dolcetto is juicy, it's affordable, it's very well-loved in Piedmont, and it's a wonderful variety as well. Usually made pure by itself.
还有除了以上提到的两个葡萄品种呢，还有两个葡萄品种是在皮埃蒙特非常重要的。第一个就是多姿桃，这个葡萄品种的价格也是它用它酿造的葡萄酒的酒款，它的价格也是非常的亲民的。这个葡萄品种呢，它跟之前提到的巴贝拉不同，它的那个单宁含量是比较高的，而且它尝起来比较的多汁。它比较适合和肉类来相搭配，同时它其实也是一个非常受欢迎的皮埃蒙特的一个品种，常常是单一葡萄品种的，我们可以看到的是常常是使用它这单独这一个葡萄品种来酿造的酒款。
So what best to talk about Barolo than to actually drink a Barolo? So we have a 2011 La Spinetta Vigneto Garetti Barolo. And this is a great producer who is doing amazing things. They own property both in Piedmont and Tuscany. And I would say that they're not traditional, but they're also not fully modern. So it's a very good combination of modern and traditional. And this Barolo, even at just 6 years old, is incredibly open and accessible.
现在呢，我们经理就来品鉴我们本次直播的第三个酒款。这第三个酒款呢，是2011年的斯宾尼塔酒庄加莱迪巴罗洛红葡萄酒。而这款葡萄酒，它的酿酒的酒庄可以说它的风格是一种传统跟现代相结合的方式。这款酒呢，现在虽然只有6年的时间，相对于它这个酒款来说，6年的陈酿时间是比较短的。可是呢，它现在已经是一个非常适应的状态，它的风味已经被打开了。
So Barolo, as a region, for it to be classified as a Barolo, needs to be aged for at least 3 years. So it's exactly 38 months. And part of that has to be in oak. And Barbaresco, as a comparison, has a lower aging requirement. And so the difference is because Barbaresco, as a region, was always a little bit more early ripening. It's a warmer, drier region, even though Barolo and Barbaresco are right next to each other. And it means the grapes ripen earlier, and they're also ready to drink a little bit earlier with less aging potential.
在上市之前呢，巴罗洛酒款一般要经过至少三年时间的陈酿，其中呢有一部分时间必须要在橡木桶当中度过。巴巴莱斯科呢，它比巴罗的要求的陈酿时间要短一些，只需要经过两年。虽然他们这两个产区巴罗洛跟巴巴莱斯科非常的靠近在地理上，可是呢，巴巴莱斯科因为它的气候会更加炎热一些，所以它的风格是更早熟一些的。
So this Barolo, part of the reason why I say it's kind of a modern style is because half of it was aged in 600 liter French oak. And this gives it a kind of creaminess, a bit of a toastiness. And you can see that it's been aged for... It's been aged for over 20 months, and you can see the tannins have really softened, and it's been able to combine and produce a more velvety, firm tannins rather than tough, traditional Barolo tannins. And this is what Spinetta has been doing really well with their wines, managing the tannins.
这款酒为什么刚才 Jeannie 提到了现代风格呢？因为它这款酒是在600升容量的橡木桶内进行陈年的，所以我们在品尝的时候呢，可以品尝到一些烘烤的风味，因为已经经过了20个月的陈酿时间，所以它的干宁非常的柔和，可以说是一种丝滑的口感。
But just because it's been aged for 20 months in oak doesn't mean that they release it right away. What they do is they hold it back. And in fact, La Spinetta did not release this wine until 4 years after the harvest. So the typical is for a Barolo is 3 years, but it's very normal for producers to keep it for even longer. So it's a huge cost to them, but they feel that they want to release the wine and when it's more ready to drink.
这款酒呢，虽然它已经经过了20个月的陈酿时间，但是并不是说，酒庄呢就立马就把这款酒上市了，而是又把这款酒呢经过了4年的陈酿时间。其实呢，在法定规定呢，只需要经过3年时间的陈酿就可以上市了。不过，除了我们今天除了斯宾塔这个酒庄之外，其实还有很多的酒庄，他们是更趋向于花更长的时间去陈酿那款酒，虽然说会花费更多，可是呢，他们希望这款酒呢，在上市时候它的状态是更佳的。
So in the beginning, I mentioned that having reserva on the label sometimes, you know, doesn't mean it's an indication of quality. But here in Barolo and Barbaresco, when you see reserva on the label, it means that the wine definitely has the ability and the concentration to be able to withstand a fairly long period of aging. Because once you get to reserva level for Barolo, it means that it's been aged in the cellar for at least 5 years. And for Barbaresco, it's been aged for 4 years. So much longer than the typical DOCG requirement. So it is a sign of quality in these two regions. So look out for reserva on the label.
Jeannie 这里呢讲到了 reserva 珍藏这个酒标术语。当我们在酒标上面发现这个术语的时候，我们基本上是可以断定它是一个质量比较好的酒款。因为如果是相对于巴罗洛和巴巴莱斯科来讲的话，因为巴罗洛和巴莱斯科在上市之前呢，经过了他们的陈酿时间是比其他的法定产区要更长的，巴罗洛需要陈酿5年的时间，而巴巴莱斯科呢需要经过4年的陈酿时间才能够上市，而这么长的陈酿时间其实是比大部分的 DOCG 都要长的。
So I'm really enjoying this young Barolo from Giorgio Rivetti. I think he's doing a great job at Spinetta. And while I'm sipping this, maybe we can take a few questions since we have a few minutes. I know that
okay.
The viewers had lots of questions before, so we'll choose a few.
那么我们现在呢就进入最后的一个问答环节了。我现在在同样的为 Jeannie 挑选一些问题。这个问题呢是问超级托斯卡纳有哪一些独特之处呢？
What makes Super Tuscan is distinct from otherwise?
Well, Super Tuscans as a group were called rebels in Tuscany because they just didn't follow the rules. And the reason they didn't want to follow the rules is because they wanted to make their own rules. They wanted to plant Cabernet, they wanted to plant Merlot, and all these international varieties that the Italians, who are so proud of their heritage and of their grapes, felt that you were being a traitor. You were going outside and taking other countries' varieties and planting it in the country. So there was a huge disagreement, but the one distinguishing factor about Super Tuscans is that they wanted to work with international varieties outside of just Sangiovese and the Tuscan varieties.
超级托斯卡纳最不同的一个地方就是他们并不遵守 DOC 和 DOCG 他们这个法定他们这个制度的法规，他们想要创造出自己的一套法规来，那就是他们不使用桑娇维塞来酿酒，他们想要尝试呢使用国际品种来酿酒。
So the other distinguishing factor was really because they wanted to make plush, more approachable wines, especially ability to enjoy and drink earlier. So they went for ripeness, they went for preservation of fruit rather than the dissipation over time and long maceration or long aging of having all those characters disappear. So they tried to preserve the flavor and fruit character as much as possible, starting from the vineyard and through to the winemaking.
第二个不同之处呢，就是酒庄超级托斯卡纳想要营造一种更加易饮的风格，这种风格呢跟传统不同，就是它可以在年轻的时候就饮用，并且呢它想要保留更多的葡萄品种的特征，葡萄品种本身的那个风味。
And the debate that's still going on right now, both in Piedmont as well as in Tuscany, is the use of small French barriques. Traditionally, Italian wines were made in large oak casks, and there was really no exchange of oxygen, no influence from the toasting of the oak, because these were all very large barrels. And so when the French barriques came in, it started to change the character of the wine. Sometimes it made it a little bit sweeter, and because of the oxygen coming into the small barrels, it softened the tannins, especially when it was young. So there was a lot of interchange and evolution of flavors. And the modern producers embraced it, whereas the traditionalists said, no, that is not our identity, that is not our style. And the debate still lingers. And for a lot of the producers, I think the best ones, they actually do take the best of both worlds. They're neither traditionalists, neither are they modernist. They're a little bit of both, and they take the best of both.
还有第三点 Jeannie 提到的就是现在呢有很多的酒庄他们开始使用小橡木桶来酿酒，这个是受到很大的争议的，因为很多坚持传统风格的酒庄他们认为这样就改变了他们传统的一个风格，这是他们一个代表的风格，是不应该去改变的，因为使用小橡木桶很多时候因为它比较小，所以它的氧气的会进入橡木桶更多，所以跟那个酒的相互作用会更加的剧烈，所以有时候酒就会更甜，单宁会更加的柔和，但是也有一些，现在也有一些酒庄呢，他们保持一个中立的态度，柔和了传统风格跟现代风格。Jeannie认为呢，这样的一个风格其实是分别取了传统风格跟现代风格的精华，他们的表现是更加的。
So I know we're running out of time, so I'm going to just summarize, what I think Italian wines are all about. And of course, it's generalizing to a very big extent, but I do think the wines express three very different and special characteristics. I would say, first, Italian wines are very diverse. Second, they're very individualistic. The producers are generally very small, they're family-oriented, and they're individual, they're very different from each other. And the third is that there's amazing, unique characters because of all these great Italian varieties that are indigenous, that you don't see outside of Italy. And it's a very special thing when you can only go to that country to experience that kind of wine and style and flavor. That's the uniqueness, diversity, and individuality.
那在节目的最后呢 ，Jeannie 想要三个词来形容和概括一下意大利的酒款的风格。他使用的这三个词，第一个是多样性，第二个呢是个性化，第三个是独一性。为什么说独一性呢？其实很大程度上是由它的葡萄品种造成的，因为这些品种很多是很难在意大利这个国家的这个国家以外的国家发现的，所以呢，这个品种使意大利如此的不同。那我们到现在呢，节目又接近尾声了。在节目的最后呢，我想告诉大家一个好消息。这个好消息就是呢，现在我们红酒世界网上商城正在进行一个购买经典 DOCG 酒款，满499元减80元的优惠。那除了我们今天品鉴这三款酒之外呢，还有其他二十多款精选酒款在我们的网上商城等着你们哦。那我们的直播就到这里了。
Thank you, Molly.
Thank you. 感谢大家的收看。